Warning, the following podcast contains adult themes and mature language. If you feel that you will be offended, you know what, screw this script, I don't need a damn script. If you don't like cussing or sex jokes, get out now. I don't know. She has Totopet there with a camera, and he's recording it. But the reason is she's using her magic to, like, broadcast it so that the Zoo Rangers can watch Goshi get his ass kicked.
Okay, all right. Yeah, she really likes the whole, let's watch the other Zoo Rangers watch one of their own die. Like, she really likes that.
She's fucked up.
She is fucked up, and she has every right to be.
She's actually a very threatening villain, which is a...
She's really fucked. She's like a supernatural version of the Joker. Or of, like, I guess, like Harley Quinn.
I can see that.
She's, like, really, really scary.
She gives that speech in the first episode about how barren wastelands are beautiful and she's going to turn the Earth into a barren wasteland. I'm like, holy shit!
And you know the thing that really, like, I really dug about the show from the get-go? And not from the get-go, it was actually a couple episodes in where they brought this up. So, the whole show, Bandora is fucking insane.
Mm-hmm.
And she's also terrifying, but we don't know anything about her. All we know is that we don't even know the backstory of, like, what happened, what do they say, 170 million years ago?
Right.
However long ago it was. We don't even know that. Like, they don't even explain who the Zoo Rangers are until episode 2.
Yeah, we haven't learned all that yet. All we know is that she really hates children.
She really hates children. That they do that in the first 10 minutes. And I was like, God damn it, I wish I would have watched this without knowing the plot of the entire show.
Yeah.
Because that foreshadowing is so good. Like, it's too good for... Like, it's like, you got, like... It's like, you need... Like, I'm so glad that I knew as little as I did about the show in regards to how good it actually is compared to Power Rangers. Because, well, it's equally as goofy, if not even more so in some instances... It is just a better story.
Indeed.
Like, just bar none. Like, it's just better storytelling. The stakes are higher. Like, there are episodes where it's like... Like, the episode, the two-parter where they go into the realm of despair, whatever it was called.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I literally don't know how they're going to get out of this, because this is a fucked up situation.
Yeah. It's an...
And the way they get out of it is kind of stupid, but whatever. It was fine.
It's a great show.
But anyway, it is really good. I'm really happy with it.
But anyway, the Zoo Rangers are sitting here watching Goshi get his ass kicked because this new Dora monster has this magical sword that's said to be the most powerful sword from hell, and not even their legendary weapons can defeat it. So Goshi's getting his ass kicked, and they're sitting, standing there like, what are we going to do? How are we going to help him? And then all of a sudden, Geki just goes, I've got it. We'll jump into the television.
Oh, man.
And they did. They jumped into the television.
Now, wait a second. To be fair, to attempt to give it some kind of logical anchor, they do set a precedent for traveling interdimensionally very early on.
Yeah, but it's
like,
never,
when they introduce the Zoo Rangers, they are traveling from a different dimension.
But they've never shown the ability to just be able to say, hey, I've got it. We'll jump into the television.
It is dumb. But that's not like, I don't know if I'd call that jumping the shark. I was more like, did they really just solve a life-threatening... My whole thing was, like, the one thing that Super Sentai and Power Rangers seems to have in common is they love fucking magic tears, because, like, fucking episode 4 of Zoo Ranger, it's like, oh, this kid is trapped in stone, how are we gonna get him out? Magic tears.
I really got some... Pokemon the movie flashbacks.
I thought the same thing. I was like, also the end of Power Rangers in Space when Andros cries on Corone and she turns back into Corone.
Yeah.
And I was just like, It makes a little bit, it's a little bit cooler in G-Ranger, though, because it's like a precedent for what that dimension is. Though, technically, given the rules of that dimension, shouldn't she have turned into stone because she started crying?
You might think so, but let's not overcomplicate things.
True. It's still, it is still a kid's show, but it's really, really good. I'm really happy with it.
What episode did you say you were on?
I'm on the second part of the Dora Sphinx two-parter.
Okay, then I was about to ask you what you thought of something, but you haven't gotten there yet, so.
Yeah, I'm probably gonna watch more of it tomorrow when I have a probably Sunday when I have a day off.
Yeah.
So I'm really happy with it though. It's a really good show. I can't wait to get to the fucking.
It's an excellent show, and I've only I just watched episode 15, and I'm super excited because the Green Ranger comes in on episode 17.
Oh, don't spoil anything about that story arc for me, because I know very little about it except what Mr. Fusion said in those videos. So I really can't wait to get to that series.
So I'm only one episode away from some Green Ranger action, and based on the preview, episode 16 looks like it's going to be pretty bad. But
oh.
I know that there's a silver lining.
There's a green aura in the distance.
The title of episode 16 is The Great Sneeze Plot.
Oh yeah, some of the titles are really stupid. The thing that I don't like about the show from the get-go is I'm getting really sick of all the fucking labeling that they do. There's always words on screen, and it drives me crazy. And I'm not talking about the subtitles, I'm talking about just what's on the show. Like, they label everything. And I'm like, I didn't need this.
Whenever a new character comes up, they're like, this is what it's called, and you're like...
Yeah, it's like, I feel like I'm watching fucking Pokemon. It's like, I don't need that. It's like...
There's also something interesting about the DVD that I've noticed. When I watched the first 11 episodes for the first time, obviously I wasn't watching this DVD. I was watching whatever online subtitle group had done those...
Did you start from the beginning when you got the DVDs, or did you just jump into where you were?
I just jumped back in on episode 12.
Oh, okay.
I rewatched the first episode, I think, when I got the first copy of the DVD, the damaged one. I went ahead and watched the first episode because it was like I wanted to see how the quality was, and I was.
By the way, once I got it, I totally understood why you had to send it back, because I got it and I'm like, oh my god, there's 10 discs in here, and this thing's it already feels pretty shaky.
Yeah, it's really flimsily designed, and I don't understand why they had to do it that way, because fucking Ultraman is also a long-ass show, and it had multiple discs, but they didn't do this, like, weird multi-layer floppy thing. I don't know how to describe it.
I'm glad they did that as opposed to the Batman TAS box set, which is like a fucking cavalcade of madness.
Yeah, I understand. I didn't even try to explain it when we were talking last week, because I was like, I'm not going to be able to explain how they set up this weird 10-disc system. But
well, I mean, I got it the very next day, so it was all good.
And you were like, oh.
I understand now.
But anyway, the subtitles... When I watched the first 11 episodes, I watched them online from whatever subtitling group had done those episodes. Mm-hmm. And the subtitles on those were fine, too. But there's slight differences in the translation that threw me off at first. Like, for instance, names of Bandora's, like, servants are spelled kind of differently. Like, in the ones I was watching, it was... The bat vampire dude, his name was it was spelled Totopat, which is kind of how Bandora pronounces it when she says she's like
that's the one that's one of Squat and Babu in Power Rangers, right?
Yeah, which is how I think they were spelling it the way Bandora pronounces it, because she doesn't, because on the DVD it's spelled Totpat, but she says Totopata. So
yeah, well, that's one of the weird things. It's like, I don't really... When you're watching a Japanese show in Japanese, it's kind of hard to listen to the pronunciation of things because you're just reading it.
Yeah.
So it's almost just like, blah, 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 and then you're just reading what the fuck the basic like gibberish to your own ear sounds like.
The other one is Bookback, the little troll looking guy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Whatever the other one of that duo.
On the ones that I watched originally, it was spelled B-U-K-B-A-K, which made sense. But I guess on the DVD they just decided to spell it phonetically, because it's literally spelled book back.
Yeah, they're spelling a lot of things phonetically, I've noticed.
Yeah.
I'm getting a little... And this is just because I'm still getting used to watching binge watching a show with DVDs because I've gotten so spoiled with Netflix now. Like, it skips over the intros and everything, so now I have to do that.
It's great while you're working on a single disc. Then you have to change discs, and that's a pain in the ass.
Yeah, it's that's all good. But the other thing, it's like, I like the theme song. I love the theme song. I kind of have a that ending theme is kind of a guilty pleasure because it's fucking ridiculous, but I love it. It sounds like it takes me right back to my childhood. But I'm like, I don't want to listen to it every half hour while I'm watching it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I'm not planning on burning through this show like I am with Buffy. Like, I'm almost done with season 2 of Buffy. This show, it's like, I don't want to hate this show because right now I'm really enjoying it because I'm taking it really slow.
My problem is I've got, like, multiple things that I'm trying to watch. I got this. I'm still working on fucking G Gundam. I still have to finish watching Ultra 7.
How long is that show?
Ultra 7?
Yeah. It's weird. It's weird to describe Japanese television to people who don't follow it, because it's like when you're like, oh, it's this show. And it's like, oh, how many seasons are there? It's like, it doesn't really work that way. They don't do seasons in Japan.
It's like one big season. Well, some shows have seasons, but that's not the norm.
The animes do have seasons, but it's like, with their live-action shows, at least the tokusatsu stuff, I mean, I can't speak to, like, their dramatic stuff, but...
There are 49 episodes of Ultra 7.
Yeah, but they didn't then do a season 2 of Ultra 7. They did another Ultraman series that was a different character, right? Like they do with Super Sentai.
Exactly. It's just taking me a while to get through Ultra 7. I'm not sure why. But, you know, the same thing happened when I watched Ultraman. It took me a while to binge watch. I didn't really binge watch Ultraman. I watched some here and some there. So,
because you're not really supposed to binge watch a show like that.
And then I've still got fucking my bootleg of Japanese Spider-Man. So I've just got too many things on my plate to watch.
Right. Well, it's like, you know, the thing with G Ranger, it's like I always want it to be there so I can just go to it when I want. But yeah, well, okay. So in addition to watching Buffy. And watching Zoo Ranger, I'm also playing through all three Gears of War games, and I just beat Gears of War 2, I'm on Gears 3. So it's almost like I'm binge playing those games. So it's like, I've got that, Buffy, Zoo Ranger, and then I've been like, just like absorbing movies lately, just stuff that I haven't seen because I feel inclined now. My film professors like try to guilt trip you, and like, you have to watch like movies like every day, because that's what's gonna make you learn, and I'm like, all right. Not that that's a bad thing, but it's like, you know, it's like, so I rewatched Close Encounters. And by the way, we're recording already, so we might as well introduce the show. Hello, everyone. I am Zazubaar, and welcome to this week's episode of The Demons from Outer Space, episode 54. Joining me, as always, Dillion McCandless, a.k.a. SuperDM64.
Hello, everyone. And guess what? Apparently, Daskade means help me in Japanese, because that might just be the phrase that I hear the most often in Jew Ranger. There's always some kids yelling at the top of their lungs, Daskade! And I'm like,
Daskade!
And I'm like, help those fucking kids, Jesus.
Yeah. Well, the other thing is, like, just to get back to, I mean, we recorded the conversation about Jew Ranger, so everybody knows what we're talking about. The characters are really good in terms of the Zoo Rangers themselves. Like, they don't all get really in-depth characterizations, but Dad...
They all get moments later on, though.
Yeah, well, I'm only on episode 7.
Yeah,
and
yeah. For instance,
the best moment...
For instance, episode that I watched not long ago, I think it was episode 13, that episode is completely centered on May, which was sorely needed because she's...
Yeah, she's the most underdeveloped character, and she's also... But she seems to be the most, like, straight-laced, like, the most... Maybe with the possible exception of Geki, like, the most serious... Oh, you know what? That's wrong, too. Goshi's really serious, too.
Oh, Goshi's, like, the intense one.
Goshi almost seems like he's more of the leader than Geki is. I mean, Geki has to be the leader because he's the Tyranno Ranger, and he's the fucking most, like, you know, powerful and everything. But Goshi will have moments where it's like, everybody get your fucking shit together and let's fucking do this, because you're all acting like idiots. Especially when dealing with Dan and Boy.
Everyone else is so, like, well-balanced, like, but then Goshi's just, like, fucking, like, intense. Like,
I'm really hoping they do an episode about, like, just about him, because, like, he's really interesting. I want to know what the fuck happened 170 million years ago that made him such a fucking, not a prick, but just such a stick in the
mud. Oh, you're going to like episode 15, then?
Oh, I'm so excited.
Despite the TV jumping.
Oh, yeah, you just mentioned that was an episode about him. Well, I'm excited about that. But Dan really intrigued me in the last episode that I watched, which was the first part of the Dora Sphinx two-parter, which, oh my god, that two-parter is good. Like, really, really good. It's fun. It almost came off like, it really struck me like Doctor Who meets Batman. You know, like 60s Batman in a weird way.
Cause it's okay, like, I like Batman.
Yeah, like 60s Batman, like, because it's like, it's over-the-top superhero stuff, but the way the characters talk is, it feels very, like, this, like, Dora Sphinx feels very reminiscent to me of a Doctor Who villain.
Mixed with the Riddler. My God, you're right.
Yeah, absolutely, because it's like he's interdimensional and he's got power, he's got, like, cosmic abilities, but he's also really, he's funny, he's sarcastic, he's hyper-intelligent, and he's an asshole. So he's kind of a mix of, like, a Doctor Who villain meets a Batman villain. I guess you could compare him to, like Mr. Mixelplick and the Riddler in that way. I know Mr. Mixelplick isn't a Batman villain.
The only annoying thing about him is that he would always make that bing bong noise.
Oh, that was a bing bong. It's like, shut the fuck up, old man.
I'm like, I want to punch you in the face right now.
What I also thought was really weird was, so obviously his natural form is not the human. It's obviously the Dora monster look that he has when he blows people away and turns them into trees.
Right. The human form is there to entice children.
Right, which is really fucking creepy.
Well, you know, it's already creepy enough because the Jew Rangers obviously take the time to learn the names and get to know every fucking child in this fucking Tokyo.
I mean, did they ever specifically say that it's Tokyo, though?
Yeah, because, you haven't gotten to it, but there's an episode where there's the Tokyo Tower.
I mean, I assumed it was Tokyo from the first episode, but I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure if it was like, you know, like if it was just some fucking bullshit Japanese city that they made up. But anyway,
in episode 14, you see the Tokyo Tower, and something happens to it, so it's clearly Tokyo. But every time something happens to a kid, they're just like, "Hey, it's so and so," and I'm like, "Do you know all the children? Like all of them? Are you?"
They haven't done that yet. Like as of right now, the only time that happened, it made sense because it was what's his fucking name? Barza's grandson.
Yeah. Well, there was just,
which I thought they didn't make a big enough deal out of that, by the way, that it was like that was his family that they were going to see. Or at least I perceived it that way. I don't know, maybe it was just a term of endearment, maybe they're not actually related, but I thought that was underplayed, like that they're like the mother therefore must either be his daughter, or again, maybe it's just like a term of endearment. But my point is that there's a personal connection there.
You did misinterpret that, because I don't remember anything about him having a grandson, now that I think about it.
Well, he runs out, and he goes, "Grandpa, you know, I love you, I'll see you later." And he goes, "Oh, that boy is full of energy." So, but I'm like, this guy is 170 million years old.
Yeah, I just took that to be like, Grandpa, like the way that sometimes kids call old people Grandpa, you know,
yeah, maybe.
Like you're in
I'm not sure.
Traffic and you're like, "Move it, Grandpa."
But I mean, maybe it's a term of endearment. Like, "Oh, this old guy's around a lot. He's very nice to me, so I'm just going to call him Grandpa." Like some people call, you know, like their parents, friends, like uncle, if it's like a really close friend who is around the family a lot. Like you can call him uncle.
I also wonder if maybe, do you remember which episode this was?
Yeah, it was the first part of the one where they get the weapons. Where they go into the dimension of despair.
Maybe I should go back and watch that episode, not on the DVD, but those other versions, those other subtitle ones that I had downloaded, because it might be an issue of translation.
That's true too. And also, it's also like, here's the problem with watching a show from another country, especially a kid show. We don't know the slang, and also this show is over 20 years old. We don't know the slang of the time, and we don't know the cultural, like, implications of calling somebody grandpa. Like, it could be different. Like, I mean, we know quite a bit more about Japan than we might about other countries we might watch TV shows from, but even still, it's like, we don't know what they do over there. It's like, you know, I've seen Godzilla movies, and it's like, that doesn't tell me, like, the cultural status of Japan.
No, it pretty much just tells me that they can run from giant monsters.
Well, that means that when you watch Godzilla movies, they're almost more kind of globally aware, is the term I'm going to say, because it's like, Toa almost seems to know a lot of people from other countries, especially the U.S., are going to watch this movie. So let's not make it too dependent upon the culture of our country.
Yeah, you know, I'm kind of glad that I became aware of Japanese media through Godzilla for that very reason, because it's kind of
because it's not inundated with references to stuff that we don't understand.
It's a nice way to sort of ease Western audiences into Japanese media,
right?
Like kaiju films and Godzilla shit, and then you go watch some anime and you're like, what the fuck.
Yeah, when you start to watch their TV shows, it becomes more like... Well, because it's like... Again, those movies are so globally popular that I think that's why. But then it's like you watch something like Jew Ranger, where it's like it was never... I mean, of course, I know Power Rangers used the fight footage, but even still, it's not like... We never saw Jew Ranger in the U.S. until now.
Exactly. In its original form, yeah.
And it was never really intended to travel the world, I suppose. At least as far as I know. So I think they're more like, well, you know, kids are the most tapped into the modern pop culture, so we're going to make it more like that. So I think that maybe that's a problem we might have, again, especially that it's over 20 years old.
One good thing about the show is that it uses a lot of Western sort of mythology.
Yeah, it's very kind of like medieval fantasy. And to be fair, Japan has a ton of medieval fantasy, but it's not like the whole... It strikes me more as like a Lord of the Rings type of fantasy rather than more of like a Birth of Japan type fantasy.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, because I remember as a kid there would be like little cultural references in things like DBZ, and I would be like, the fuck?
Yeah, DBZ is even more so like ingrained in Japanese mythology,
and
we're actually Chinese mythology more so.
Yeah, Chinese mythology seen through the lens of Japanese culture is kind of interesting.
Which is really, really bizarre. Like I know everybody who knows DBZ, it's based on Journey to the West heavily, especially Dragon Ball. Not so much DBZ, but even then, the stuff that was based on Journey to the West obviously carries through DBZ.
I remember.
Though DBZ is a little bit more of a modern type of story.
I remember when I was a kid and I was first becoming aware of the fact that these shows were not from America. Like, you know, I remember very specifically watching, like, an episode of Digimon and just, like, stopping all of a sudden and being like, wait a minute, that billboard is not in English.
Yeah, I never picked up on that until I was older either. I mean, I was, like, Pokemon, thought it was an American show. DBZ... See, DBZ takes place in such a never-never land that it almost could take place. It could almost, like, it's almost more understandable, like, oh, this is an American show.
Yeah. And then, you know, there's always a moment in, like, an anime where, like, a character will start eating, like, a rice ball. And it's like, I didn't know what the fuck a rice ball was.
Yeah, they called them donuts in Pokemon, and I'm like, that's not a fucking donut.
I've seen donuts, man.
Yeah, like, I remember, this is so ingrained in my memory because of how confused I was. I remember asking my parents, and they had no fucking clue. Or my mom, rather. I didn't ask my dad about this. I can't talk to my dad about Pokemon.
it's a tough subject.
It's a touchy subject with them Pokemans.
Pokemon killed his brother. Dropped a piano on his head.
Dropped the Pokeball on his head.
He didn't understand that you can't capture humans. It was pretty sad.
Yeah, he was really confused. He gave him a massive concussion, brain injury. It was just a mess.
You have to damage it first. Oh.
Oh. I'm going to get a critical. So, got the VHS tape, which was three episodes of Pokemon. The first one was where Ash, Brock, and Misty were catching that monkey-looking Pokemon. And they were in, like, a desert. Do you remember this at all? Remember that monkey-looking Pokemon that was white? It didn't have a mouth?
Kinda.
Well, it was... They were trying to capture one, and Brock made, like... Because he was, like, the cook. He made rice balls, and he's called them jelly donuts. And I'm like, that's not a fucking donut.
Why not? Okay, if you're gonna say donut so that kids don't get confused, I can understand. Why make the leap and call it a jelly donut?
Well, I don't know.
There's clearly no jelly in that donut.
There's obviously no jelly in it. I guess because jelly... Here's what I think their logic was.
Is this...
Well, we don't want to call them rice balls because we still want to trick kids into thinking that this show is made in America. But so what can we call it in terms of an American dessert or American pastry that'll be comparable? Well, jelly donuts don't have holes in them. So that's close, right? It's like, all right, fine, jelly donut. But it's like, then they bite into it, and it's like, there's no jelly in it. It's fucking black.
I remember thinking, Pokemon, I love you, man, but you really suck at drawing donuts, because...
Is
this the Pokemon you were talking about?
Probably. I don't remember any of the names. I really don't care about Pokemon anymore. So I know some people do. That's cool. I just don't.
Yeah, I just...
Yeah, that's the one.
I just typed in monkey Pokemon, and a bunch of monkey Pokemon popped up, and I just clicked on the one I remembered.
Yeah, this is back when Pokemon was real, man. This is back when Pokemon was, like, the real
thing.
Pokemon was real. This is back when you could realistically catch them all. Nowadays,
You can't catch all them motherfuckers.
I'm sure somebody has, and I pity them, but,
oh my god, that's terrifying.
What?
Somebody did an image of what this Pokemon would look like in real life.
Those images terrify me. Because they look like the most horrible monsters in the world. Although I guess it's like going from the chibi Godzilla from that anime we watched last week to the Godzilla that we all know and love.
Just click this long-ass link that I just sent. So long-ass because the fucking...
Holy shit, dude!
Yeah. Isn't that terrifying? Looks like a fucking cryptid.
Whoa, yeah, it does. It looks like... I don't know why they gave it a pig nose.
Well, because the original Pokemon kind of had a pig-looking nose.
It looks like the, it looks like a skunk ape, which is the Floridian Sasquatch that smells like shit. And if you see supposed pictures of it, the thing looks fucking terrifying, and it looks like that. It
kind of gives me hope that a Pokemon movie could work.
I don't need a Pokemon movie. Somebody out there needs a Pokemon movie, but I don't need a Pokemon. I saw a trailer, like a live-action trailer for like a fan film, and we'll get into fan films in a second, kids.
Not that it could work, but that it would look cool.
Yeah, and this one did. It was they played it very gritty and realistically. The words we'll use a lot tonight. It was really good. It was like Ash was part of like this like black market underground Pokemon battle ring. And Brock and Misty were trying to get him to get out of it, and it was kind of played as a parody, kind of. But I was like, I would watch this Pokemon movie. If I'm going to go to a movie theater and watch a live-action Pokemon movie, this would be the one to get me to go. And when I watched it, I was like, if they ever do a live-action Yu-Gi-Oh! Movie, this is what I want it to be like. I don't want it to be like some kind of bullshit fantasy movie. I want it to be like about the culture. I don't want it to be about the fucking monsters, because the monsters aren't real. I mean, they were in the anime, but like do it like season zero, where it's not like, I mean, there was magic present, but it wasn't the focal point.
Oh my god, this is a combination of frightening and adorable.
Those two things are not mutually exclusive, Dylan.
I want it.
What is it? Pikachu real? That's not frightening. That's fucking adorable. It's a real Pikachu. Now my question is that Photoshopped or did somebody fucking like Dr. Moreau together this fucking rodent to look like Pikachu? Because if so, that's fucking horrible.
I'm kind of hoping for the second one because then I could realistically get one.
Dylan, you're not Dr. Moreau. You can't fucking do that. You can't.
No, I want to.
You don't have a House of Pain.
I want to contact. Well, I'll tell you. I want to contact Dr. Moreau and be like,
my house is the House of Pain.
I want to contact fucking Dr. Moreau and be like, I want it.
Because you know he's a real, because he's a real person.
I want it.
And after realizing that you're talking to a fictional character, you decided to just give up on it and go back to living a sad life in the House of Pain. So, Dylan, we went on a bunch of tirades already. I have no idea where all of them started or where they all stopped.
No, I feel like I was trying to make a point at some point that I
passed. I feel like I was trying to make several points, and I never made any of them. So when I listen back to this in a couple days and edit it, I'm going to be really mad at myself because I probably was trying to say something kind of cool, and I never got to say it because we just put on so many fucking tirades.
I don't remember what we were talking about before we got back onto Jew Ranger.
Oh, don't even try. Well... But let's use that as a segue, shall we, to talk about what we pre-planned to talk about tonight. So speaking of dark, gritty, realistic fan films, and also speaking of Power Rangers and DBZ, Dylan, you and I are going to kind of do a review, but also just talk about our feelings. I guess that's a review. We're going to give our thoughts on two live-action fan films that we watched this week, that came out this week.
We're not going to review...
Both of them highly publicized.
We're not going to review them. We're just going to give our thoughts on them, as well as offer some critical reception of them.
Well, I kind of don't want to use the word review, because I feel like this is going to get very, like, talking about the reaction more than it is, like, oh, this is what this does right, this is what it does wrong. And
I mean, I have complaints with both of them.
As do I, but I almost more want to talk about the public reaction, especially to the Power Rangers one, and everybody's going to know. So let's not beat around the bush. So obviously, unless you're living under a rock or you just have no interest in these things, and I don't even know if you, even if you didn't have interest, you probably heard about it because it was reported on by major, major news sources, like EW wrote articles about it. The people who made the two fan films, Punisher Dirty Laundry, which actually featured Thomas Jane, who played the Punisher in 2004, and also featured a cameo by Ron Perlman, came out like at a Comic-Con a couple years back. Very, very good, very, very well liked and popular. And then they also made one that I haven't heard so much about, but I watched it, and it's really fucking good, with Venom, Truth, and Journalism. The people who produced that, or those two things, came together and made a really weird Power Rangers fan film called Power-Rangers. And their whole premise was, let's take Power Rangers and make it R-rated.
We're taking Power Rangers Super Serial.
Yes, and as it's really, really epic.
It's fucking
so
awesome.
here's the weird thing. I'm really glad I knew nothing about this before. I mean, I knew it was R-rated. I knew it was going to be dark, but I just literally was on Facebook, saw it on my timeline, and I was like, I got to fucking watch this.
I didn't really know this was happening. Is this the same thing as those, like, MMPR images that were going around, or is this a separate fan?
No. This is a totally different thing.
Okay.
The people who are making MMPR commented on this, and they're like, eh. Here's the thing. This movie has been... I didn't think a fan film could be this controversial. I mean, I guess it makes sense given that it's fucking Power Rangers and that this movie is super, super violent.
I love it.
Here's how I'm going to pitch it to those, and I'll put a link to it in the description. We're not going to do a commentary because I just don't want to. I'll put links to this and the other one we're going to talk about.
I can't do a commentary over this because I would be too busy drooling over how fucking awesome it is.
Yeah, it's so, Dillion. Would I be wrong to say that this is almost like a Watchmen-esque approach to Power Rangers?
I can see that, yeah.
Because the whole premise of this thing, as said by the producer, was, you know, when you watch Power Rangers as a kid and then you revisit it as an adult, only then do you realize how fucked up those kids would be once they grow up. And that's basically what this movie is about. It takes the very... It's a really bizarre movie because it takes the premise of Power Rangers and also some of the continuity of the first season. And it seems to mainly be basing itself upon the first season of Mighty Morphin and then on some of the stuff that they did later on. But otherwise, it's obviously a complete reboot. It doesn't really seem to be in any particular continuity. Just kind of, it's based on some of the events of the first seasons of Mighty Morphin. And this is something I have a problem with. I'll get into in a second. And it goes, all right, so they fought Rita. They lost. The Machine Empire took over. And now they're on the run, and they've all been murdered. The original five Rangers, plus obviously Tommy is off being a ghost somewhere. And it's basically deconstructing who these kids turned into after the fight against evil ended, or after evil won. And I found that really interesting, because obviously we did an episode all about Power Rangers recently, so it's been on my mind. And my whole thing with this movie was, I've never really thought that an R-rated Power Rangers movie would make sense. But the story that this one told was so cool.
Yes.
And what came out of it so really entertaining that I was like, you know what? That deserved its grittiness. I know that a lot of people do not feel that way. A lot of people really detest this movie. A lot of Power Rangers fans and people associated with Power Rangers in terms of production did not like this movie. But before we get into that, Dillion, what'd you think of the movie?
I fucking loved it. I have no qualms with the idea about a dark, gritty Power Rangers movie. I've always thought that it would be fucking awesome to see.
Yeah.
And I mean, people can just, you know, quietly go to their bathrooms and gently remove their tampons because It's not like it's in fucking canon, everybody.
That's the thing. That's the thing that I don't understand. Like, I get that people are like, you know, if Saban decide, I mean, this is going to sound weird, but if Saban was like, this is what the new movie's going to look like, I might be a little bit like, eh, I don't know if it needs to be that dark and gritty. Having seen what a dark and gritty R-rated Power Rangers movie looks like, I might actually be okay with it. But, that being said, I don't need the Lionsgate movie to look like this. I don't think it should. I've said that the new Power Rangers movie really ought to base itself on Avengers. Like, that is the template that it should follow.
I would love to actually see more fan film stuff in this version of the universe, because I find it fascinating.
I do too.
So I don't have this bias that a lot of people had going in, because I've always wanted to see what a gritty Power Rangers would look like. And so,
as have I.
So going into it with no reservations whatsoever about that sort of thing, I just sort of got to sit back and enjoy it for what it was. And I gotta say, I was blown away across the board. And this is true for both of the fan films we're talking about tonight.
Yeah, and we'll get into the other one later on.
With the fucking quality.
Yeah.
Except for one thing that I'm going to bitch about when we get to complaints.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Everything looks fucking beautiful.
Dude, how about that? I mean, it's like 2 seconds long, but how about that Megazord fight?
That was amazing.
It looked about on the same level as Pacific Rim and Transformers. I mean, to be fair, we see it for like a second, and it's at a really far distance, but that was smart, because they were able to make it look really good. I mean, basically, the Megazord is just there to get destroyed.
I mean, dude, and that fight scene with Zack and those thugs?
Yeah, that was the best part. That was easily the best part of the movie, at least action-wise.
Yeah, my favorite part of the movie, not action-wise, is the twist at the end, despite my complaint that I'll get to in a minute.
Yeah, I don't know. I also really liked, I mean, it's freaking depressing, but that sequence of Bulk and Skull, that was the thing where I was like, oh my god, that's fucked up.
That was the one moment where I was like, all right.
Yeah, I was like, that is fucked up. And it's like, again, here's why this movie really fascinated me in terms of its premise of looking at the Power Rangers as really fucked up individuals. The reason why I found it so interesting, and why I thought the gore, the violence, and the really gritty attitude worked, was because the thing that has always been really controversial about Power Rangers is that they always kill their enemies in the show. You know what I'm saying? They're not like Batman, Superman, and DC and Marvel heroes.
I hate that.
They kill the monsters they fight, with the only exception being Time Force. Every other season of Power Rangers, they use guns and swords to blow up their enemies.
Well, in SPD, they incarcerate them by putting them.
Okay, good point. But they even cards. Yeah, very very true.
And even still, they wind up having to kill some of them, if I'm remembering correctly. But
to be fair, they're also a police force. That's a little bit different. But in the original Mighty Morphin show, these are kids. They're teenagers, and
well, and the
some
other thing
random...
is, here's the main difference, I think. In SPD, these are aliens, alien criminals. You know, they're still like people.
Yes.
They're still like people with feelings and shit. In Mighty Morphin, they're fucking monsters.
They're basically demons.
We've been killing monsters forever in media.
But that's why I found it so compelling as to, like, the Power Rangers are a team of superheroes who, with really no discussion about it, kill everybody they fight. And nobody really talks about that unless you're talking about why you're a parent and why your kids shouldn't watch Power Rangers.
And, you know, it's even more pronounced in Jew Ranger, because in Jew Ranger you get a little bit more detail about how, you know, these monsters are made out of clay. They're not real creatures. They're based on real monsters in some cases.
Yeah, they're always based on something is the thing. Like, but they're not. They're basically like the demons in Angel and Buffy. They're just basically just evil incarnate. They have no soul.
Right, like,
so when you kill a vampire, it's not morally wrong, because you're not killing something that's technically alive. It's the living dead.
Because there'll be instances where, and you haven't gotten to this yet, but the episode with a monster called Dora Circe, which for MMPR people out there is the giant pig head thing.
Oh, I get it. That's clever.
In that episode, the Cersei was said to be, it's not the actual Cersei, as in the witch from the Odyssey myth, but they create this new myth about this monster called Cersei who looked like that. And so what the Dora, what Pleplacon, or Pulipulicon, as fucking Bandora likes to pronounce it, but it's clearly spelled anyway. What he does is basically take these myths and then recreate them in clay, and then they come back to life. And then there are other instances where some of them are shown. Well, they're not technically myths. Technically, they are things that supposedly happened long ago. But I'm getting too far into the mechanics here. The point is,
but yeah, it's also different in Zhu Ranger than it is in Power Rangers because of who the Zhu Rangers are. In Zhu Ranger, they're ancient warriors who are warriors. When they use their Dinobuckers for the first time, they're not using them for the first time. They did this in the past.
Yeah, this is just the first time we've seen them do it.
Yeah, it's Zhu Ranger is a very different show from Power Rangers in that way, and why I think it's so interesting to look at Power Rangers in the way that this movie did.
Yeah, with Power Rangers, these are fucking mild-mannered teenagers who like...
They're just thrown into a crazy situation.
They hang out at juice bars and go to peace conferences, and then on the side they murder monsters.
Yeah, and it's really like, and it's just it's really interesting to look at it like, you know, these guys had the power to bring the world to their knees, and they were kids, they were teenagers, and you know, there are a lot of stories, superhero stories and stuff, where it's like they deal with teenagers who get these powers and they go crazy. There's a ton of Superman stories, where his powers will get transferred to a normal guy, usually somebody younger, and they'll go nuts. They just go crazy because they're normal people with this incredible power thrust upon them, and because of all their personal biases, they use it for horrible things. And, you know, to be fair, that's a very cynical way to look at it, obviously, and obviously Power Rangers is not something that's meant to be looked at cynically. But what if we did look at it cynically, and that's what this movie is about, and that's what I found really compelling about it.
Yeah.
And here's the argument I want to make, not against the people who don't like it and say that it shouldn't exist, because whatever, that's your opinion. I think that it's perfectly acceptable for this to exist.
But given that it's a dumbass opinion, I have chosen to ignore it. No.
Yes, exactly, to quote the great Samuel L. Jackson.
Not dumbass. My apologies.
Right. The reason why I don't think there's any ground to be angry at it is because it's not an official Power Rangers thing.
Exactly.
This is somebody who is like, I have a really interesting idea for a story. Maybe nobody else will find it interesting, but it's a story I want to tell. So I'm going to tell it. And I'm not going to make any money off it. This is just because I think this is an interesting story. And to me, that is the only excuse that you need. Now, the really big argument that a lot of people are making against this movie, at least what I've heard, I want to put words in anybody's mouths, but obviously the biggest person who spoke about this movie publicly was Jason David Frank. And we'll talk about that in a second. But everybody seems to agree, like, who doesn't like this movie, that the problem with it is that you're taking – that it's kind of tarnishing the brand a little bit. Because it takes this really lighthearted kid show and takes a really hardcore cynical look at it. And to the point where I can almost see that some people might think it's irreverent to Power Rangers. Now, I disagree with that. I think it's very reverential for Power Rangers. It makes a shit ton of references.
There are references all over the place. There are clever in-jokes that play into the satire. Like
Hip-Hop Keto, yeah.
Or like the moment where he asks, like little dialogue moments when he asks, quote-unquote, Kimberly, why they would choose children, and she goes, we were the only ones that could stop Rita, and he slams his hands down on the table, and he's like, you can't be that stupid!
Yeah, absolutely. Now, here's the, let me finish this point, and then I'll get into my continuity questions. So, the whole public reception of this movie, that people who don't like it, it's like, it's bad for the brand. Power Rangers will be forever tainted by this movie because of how popular it is, and that's why Saban wants it taken down. And I'll get your opinion on this too. You know, Saban has gone after the producers of this film to take it off. It got removed from Vimeo, where it was originally put up, and then it was attempted to be removed from YouTube, but that didn't go through because you can obviously still watch it. I don't know what their claim is because they can't. I don't think they can claim copyright infringement because it's a fan film.
Yeah, it's a non-profit fan film that's not connected to them in any capacity. It's
absolutely, yeah, and it's not made for any profit. It's and it even says it's made for private use, which is, you know, a little bit wrong because it was released publicly. But anyway, you know, there's, when you don't make any money off it, it's a fan film. It's you know, I don't think that there's any ground to sue. The reason why I think they're so bent out of shape is because it's crazy popular. Like, it got 10 million views in 2 days. And the public reaction to it has been so strong, it's like, it's almost like they feel like it's, this is all my assumption, again, they haven't spoken, maybe it's a completely different thing than I'm making it out to be, but it almost feels like they're intimidated by it now. Because, A, they had nothing to do with it, and it goes against how they want people to view Power Rangers. And I can see that, but because I like the story, and because I really respect these guys for going out of their way to make something this of this quality, that was just, I want to tell the story, and I'm going to tell it, I can't condone or agree with that action. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So what's your whole response to all this stuff?
I think people are being fucking stupid. I really do. It's a fucking fan film. If you don't like fucking... you know, there are people who have negative reactions to any fan film, obviously. I'm sure that as much as we love it, there are Godzilla fans out there who probably see Godzilla Battle Royale as, you know, complete drivel.
It's been, yeah, there's been some really hard, harsh things thrown at that movie that I don't agree with.
But, and, you know, K-Sera-Sera fan film, whatever. But that's just it. It's a fucking fan. It's not connected to the actual brand. It's not going to tarnish.
The brand has nothing to do with it. It's here. It's like,
this is a brand that gets made fun of all the time anyway.
Oh, God. There's very little respect out there for Power Rangers.
Let's not act like we're tarnishing some great name here when people make fun of Power Rangers all the time. And that's what this really is. It's a satire. It's a very sort of dark and black sort of satire.
It's
not only meant to satirize what you were talking about earlier with, you know, what would happen if this sort of thing happened in real life, and like how fucked up would those people really also be. But it also takes this sort of, and this is something that Andres actually pointed out to me. I hadn't thought of it this way until he was talking about his reaction to the film to me. It takes this modern trend of making everything gritty and realistic and then applies that to Power Rangers. And so it's sort of satire in that regard as well.
It's an experiment, and I think that's the best. It's an experiment, and I don't think that there's anything wrong with experimenting. I think the day that we say that people should not experiment is the day where art kind of dies.
Yeah,
and
you know,
I'm going to go as far to call this art.
I was just about to say this. People get so used to seeing film as a commercial product.
Yes, and if there's anything in the world that you can best point to that, it's fucking Power Rangers.
People are so used to seeing film as this commercial product, and it very oftentimes is that. But at the same time, people forget that it is also art.
Yes, and it can be both. It's like, and that's the beauty of the fan film phenomenon. It's like, we get to see just the raw artistic, you know, viewpoint on this stuff. And then there's the commercial stuff. And I think the threat that people kind of get from this is, well, if any Joe Schmo can go out there and make a Power Rangers movie that looks this good, arguably better than the actual official Power Rangers thing, then shouldn't the creators have the right to shut that down because it's threatening their product? And it's a matter of just like, I see the debate, but just because of like the experimental nature of it, and because at the end of the day, it's not the end all be all Power Rangers thing. I think that's the other thing. It's like, this is not like the rest of, like, this doesn't define Power Rangers for the next, you know, for the next generation. I don't think anyway. This was just a cool little experiment, and I think the people are blowing it out of proportion.
For me to Dylan, viewers
you're
of
cutting out
space.
You cut out really bad for like a whole 30 seconds.
Yeah, I think you. Am I still cutting up?
No, you're good now.
Okay. This is going to be a really weird argument for me to make, because I've spoken about change and how it's bad and scary on the podcast before.
Right, right, right.
But a lot of these people sound like old men going, "This isn't my Power Rangers."
No, it's not. And I, exactly.
And I get it. I have the same fucking reaction to Teen Titans Go.
Exactly. It's, yeah.
The only, the only difference is that this fan film is, you know, good. But...
Yes.
So I get that sort of knee-jerk reaction, like, it's a travesty. But really, stop and think about this argument that you're making. And just how stupid it really is.
Again, it's a fan film. It's not an official release. It doesn't have any bearing on the franchise. Yeah, you know what I mean? It's
That's another difference between the two scenarios that I just laid out. Teen Titans Go.
Teen Titans Go is an official DC product.
Teen Titans Go is an official DC product that is ruining the perception of Teen Titans among the youth of America.
Power Dash Rangers, and I don't know how exactly they want it to be, said, but I'm gonna call it that to distinguish it. Is not. Again, it's a fucking experiment. And it's an experiment that I really enjoyed seeing, and I want to see more stuff along those lines. That's what's so cool about YouTube and fan films, because here's what's really cool about all this. Basically, what these fan films are, and I'm not the first person to make this argument, so I'm not going to pretend like this argument is solely my own. Fan films are basically a visual representation of people's perceptions of certain fandoms. So this Power Rangers movie is how somebody views Power Rangers, how they want to view Power Rangers. It's their interpretation. It's not the end-all, be-all version, especially since it's not an official release. There's certainly a different stigma put to an official release, because it's almost seen like the end-all, be-all version, because it's the official franchise and... You know, it's a little bit different, but because this is just a fan film made for free consumption, there's less stigma attached to it, and I think therefore there's more of a license to explore.
And think about the danger presented by trying to prevail with this argument.
Yeah, exactly.
And try to create an environment in which Power Rangers has to remain the same. If you create a climate where Power Rangers has to stay completely goofy, then you miss out on some things. Because let's not act like this is really insulting. Don't act like nothing serious or dark has ever happened in Power Rangers before.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we did a whole fucking episode on this show. We talked about, like, there are some really good stories that got told in that show.
There's the fucking... jump to Lost Galaxy, because we all know how much I like that show. Fucking Magnum Defender's kid got killed.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
there was on-screen child death in Power Rangers. Now, mind you, it still wasn't, like, rated R. Maybe that's just your, like, reaction to, it's rated R. But still, let's not act like...
Yeah, the labels that got put on this are also certainly, I think, a part of why the reaction has been so negative.
Let's not act like nothing dark or gritty is ever allowed to happen in the Power Rangers universe, because then you create a climate where you're limiting the future of the franchise. Look,
you know what I think?
Look at how Ranger does it.
Yeah, Jew Ranger definitely is.
Jew Ranger is goofy as shit. But there's also some dark motherfucking shit that goes on in it. Bandora...
They curse in Jew Ranger!
Bandora's goal in life is to kill children.
Yes,
her
exactly.
Son, there's a tragic backstory involving her son. The Green Ranger saga in it is dark as shit. You need to have goofy-ass accessible television for children, but you also don't need to cut out all the dark shit, because then, you know, you teach them that they live in this fucking bubblegum world that they really don't. So, not that...
That is, I think, a lot of the reason why a lot of people don't really look at Power Rangers as anything but drivel, which is, of course, something I don't agree with. But a lot of people look at Power Rangers that way because it doesn't look at it that way. And I think a lot of this is because people don't know that there's a franchise beyond the original Mighty Morphin series.
Exactly.
Because Mighty Morphin, with very few exceptions, was that very idealized bubblegum world where nothing of any real conflict happened aside from, there's a monster, we gotta kill it. That's pretty much it.
I mean,
like, even their version of the Green Ranger story, as fun as it was not half as dark as much conflict as
it's very
the
watered
original.
Down, and all of the consequences of that story get loopholed out of anyway. Tommy losing his powers, we'll see how long that lasts.
The other thing is that Tommy goes evil and faces no punishment for what he did.
Exactly.
To be fair, it wasn't his fault, but, you know, that was done so that way he wouldn't have to face any consequences for what he did.
Exactly. You just...
In Zyuranger, Daijujin is like, yo, you guys gotta kill that guy. He did a lot of fucked up shit.
I just don't want to create...
And guess what? Barai fucking pays for what he did in a big, bad way.
I mean, I understand that the cultural perception of Power Rangers already is this, but I don't want to create a climate where Power Rangers has to be safe. I don't want to put any franchise in a box and say, this is what you can and cannot do. That sort of thing just irks me. I think there should always be room for experimentation. I think there should always be room for, you know, originality and taking things to new dark places that they never went before. Can you imagine if DC Comics had never been allowed to become more mature than they were in their
story? Oh, comic books are the best example of this. Like, Watchmen and the Dark Knight Returns are the biggest example of how, you know, if we had never been able to experiment, we never would have gotten some really great stories. Like, the way we view Power Rangers now is how a lot of people looked at Batman in the 1970s.
Comic books.
And it
would
took
not...
a long fucking time for people to go, that's not what Batman can be. He can be something more.
Comic books would not survive in our modern climate if we were still stuck in this era of, holy long, John Silver's Batman.
Exactly. But there's still a place for that Batman, though.
There is still a place
for it. I think the best part is the best way to look at that from all sides. It's like, just because we don't have it doesn't have to just be campy, doesn't mean it can't also be campy. Brave and the Bold is fucking awesome. That show is great.
I believe it's
ultra goofy.
I believe wholeheartedly in having your cake and eating it too.
Believe wholeheartedly. It's the beautiful American concept.
I believe wholeheartedly that you should be allowed to have your goofy Batman and your gritty Batman. That you should be able to have your Heisei Godzilla and also your Showa Godzilla. And that you should be able to have goofy ass kids show Power Rangers as well as dark, gritty, fucking Zack snorting coke Power Rangers. I want both.
Especially when everybody who grew up with Mighty Morphin when it was on is now in their 20s.
Exactly. You would think that people would realize what this fan film is trying to do. It's taking this thing that you liked as a kid and fucking putting it in your modern adult perspective. It's allowing you to see that universe through a different lens. I don't understand.
And maybe that's part of what people don't like about it, is that they always wanted Power Rangers to stay there and just be locked in that box of 90s goofiness. Don't ever touch it. But I think that there's a place for looking back on that stuff with a very analytical eye and going, well, what's the potential there?
I can throw up many more examples. I believe that I should have my 1980s Ninja Turtles and my 2003 Ninja Turtles. You know,
the cartoon Turtles, the movie Turtles, and the comics Turtles, like, it's three entirely different beasts. And to use the Turtles as a comparison point, I think that the Lionsgate Power Rangers movie that they're making now should be similar to the first live-action Ninja Turtles movie, in that it's a marriage of the goofy parts of the franchise and the darker parts, and then finds a nice balance of that where kids and adults can enjoy it. Introduce kids to the mythos of the original Mighty Morphin series, but make it so it's like, you grew up with Mighty Morphin, well, let's take it to the next step.
And also, you have to have Jason fight Tommy in Central Park, and then lose, and then yell, "Damn!
Damn!" It's also like, we know, and we talked about this in the more phenomenal video we did, we know they're going to do the Green Ranger story.
Yeah, if not in the first movie, in a sequel.
I imagine they'll probably wait till the sequel, but regardless, I really want them to base it more so on the Zyuranger story than on the Power Ranger story.
I would really like it if they did sort of an amalgam of elements.
You can keep the mind control thing, but just give it more consequences than that. It's even like, I don't even like the mind control thing, but if we can't just have Tommy go bad, then fine, we'll do some mind control.
Here's something that they could change in to make it in line with the original show that I wouldn't mind, that some people would probably find blasphemous, but I wouldn't mind it. I wouldn't mind it if we called her Bandora instead of Rita.
I don't think that matters.
Rita Repulsa is a really stupid name.
Yeah, but it's also like, here's the other thing, though. We're talking about how, we, you know, dark and gritty Power Rangers is great, but I also don't want to create a climate where we can't also have, like, well, it's Power Rangers, so let's embrace the stuff that Power Rangers has about it that's original, rather than, because I think the other point that a lot of people made, the most intelligent argument against this movie that I've heard, is why does everything have to be dark and gritty now?
But that's the point.
Well, yes, but here's the other thing. I think that there's also a certain amount of, we don't need a Power Rangers. Here's the point that I made on Facebook. We don't need a Power Rangers movie with buckets of gore, you know, tons of F-bombs, and you know, this really dark and gritty story. But it was really fucking cool to see that.
Exactly.
So, you know, I just think that there's room for everything. And I think the other thing about this Power Rangers movie is that it doesn't abandon the mythos of the show and just turn it into something else entirely. It's very much so kind of like, it's almost like the events of season one happened the way we saw them, and then this is what happened afterwards in a realistic world.
Well, it's you still have your classic Power Rangers. The fact that this fan film exists doesn't stop anybody who fucking wants to from going over to Netflix right now and watching the show. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not like the existence of reinterpretations destroys what came before. If that were the case, the Godzilla franchise would have been fucked.
Yeah, exactly. A couple times over.
Conversely, if you do things in the opposite direction and create a climate where you can never change anything, that does far more damage than doing experimentation, because then you're not having both. Whereas this way, we do have both.
Here's the way I want to sum it up, because we've talked about this for like a half hour, and I kind of want to move on to just kind of looking at the movie on its own merits and reviewing it, and then we can move on to the next thing.
Now let's get off this controversy, because I'm getting angrier.
There is a balance that has to be met, where a balance between respecting the roots and taking the roots to new places. And that is a balance that pop culture, everybody on the planet will battle for forever. And we probably will never find that balance, but that is the climate that we need to live in, where we can have both, but just enough of both to make the right amount, if that makes any sense. But anyway, with all that said, let's talk about the movie on its own merits.
Here's my first major question. What the fuck happened to Alpha and Zordon?
Yeah, here's the interesting thing. So we know that... So let's talk about continuity for a second. So as I said, this movie seems to kind of be based in the storyline of season one of Mighty Morphin, because Lord Zedd is not mentioned at all. So it almost comes off to me like Rita was the threat, and then the Machine Empire came as soon as we defeated Rita.
Right.
Or as soon as we made... There's talk about some kind of treaty being made, and I don't know if that was with Rita or with the Machine Empire.
I think the idea is that Rita was defeated, because at the end, when there's the plot twist, he seems genuinely surprised that Rita was still around, and that she was the one behind it.
Right.
So I think the idea is that Rita was defeated, and then the Machine Empire came in. Similar to what happens in the show, where after Rita and Zedd get, you know, defeated and they're washed up...
Well, they don't get defeated. They actually beat the Power Rangers.
You know what I mean. They're all washed up, and the Machine Empire comes in to fill the void. Similar to that, only I guess what happened in this version of the continuity is that there was some sort of final battle. I'm assuming Zedd died, because nobody ever fucking mentions him. And
well, again, I'm assuming... Well, I also don't think Zedd is even in this continuity, because in this continuity, Tommy never even became the White Ranger.
You're right, so maybe there is no Zedd. Regardless, the point is, Rita is thought to be gone, and then the Machine Empire comes in and fills the gap, so to speak. Whether there's the whole, like... intergalactic, like, federation of different evil powers that we had in...
Yeah, the United Alliance of Evil.
Yeah, that's what it's called. Whether that exists is beyond me.
I would assume so, given that maybe what happened was Rita was a member of that, the Rangers defeated Rita, and then the United Alliance was... I'm assuming they weren't called that in this version. Maybe they were.
It's a great fucking title. The United Alliance of Evil...
listen, you need to join our alliance because we are way fucking stronger than you, and your little Power Rangers are not going to be able to stop us. We need to team up. And what seems like it happened was the Rangers were like, that's fucking bullshit, but the government was like, listen, you can't protect this forever. We have to... This is not how the real world works. We can't just keep beating every little evil force that comes along. We have to compromise. That's how reality works.
It's similar to, like, in, as much as I hate to give this movie any credit for a plot point, but this was kind of an interesting idea. It seems like in fucking Transformers 3, when the Earth is issued a ultimatum to kick the Autobots off of their world, and they're like, well, sucks to be you.
Yeah, exactly. It struck me as very similar to that. Here's my questions regarding continuity. So, first point, we're Zordon and Alpha. I'm assuming they're dead.
I'm guessing so.
I'm assuming the Machine Empire killed them, and that's why the Power Rangers fell.
I'm also
because
assuming...
I doubt Zordon would have been cool with all this.
I'm also assuming that in this version of the continuity, killing Zordon does not release a Z-wave that destroys, quote, all evil in the universe. Unless, of course, he's not dead, but rather captured.
But he's not even mentioned, though, is the thing. They don't even mention Zordon. I mean, he's kind of indirectly present because of, well, Rocky goes, we were children, chosen to battle an intergalactic war with an enemy we never met, which is really interesting, because if you think about it, he's right. In Mighty Morphin, the Power Rangers and Rita Repulsa never share screen time together.
Yeah.
They never meet. It's always Rita sends down a threat, the Rangers fight it, and then they just assume that, oh, Rita's been defeated. They never meet face-to-face until later on.
Which is way... Another example of how Jew Ranger is way different.
Yeah, Bandora battles the Jew Rangers in the first episode.
She battles them constantly. She's always popping in on their battles and being like, fuck you, here's some magic.
Yeah, she fucking hates them. I guess deservedly so, given their backstory, but anyway. So, here's my other question. So, all we see of the Power Rangers story that we know in this movie is basically the events of Season 1, so the original 5, Tommy gets introduced by Rita, Tommy joins the team, Tommy loses his powers, Tommy gets his powers back.
God creates dinosaurs. God destroys.
God destroyed. Yeah. Zordon creates Power Rangers, you know, Power Rangers destroy Zordon, whatever.
Power Rangers destroy God.
That's a fucking quote. That's like a Christian, like a concerned Christian mother, like fucking Power Rangers destroy God.
Power Rangers eat man.
Ninja Turtles inherit the earth? I don't know. No, Beetleborgs inherit the earth.
They are in the same universe.
Beetleborgs inherit the earth.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is in the same universe technically as Power Rangers, and isn't whichever version of Kamen Rider they adapted into Masked Rider also?
Technically, but we don't talk about that. but anyway, so because Masked Rider sucks. What was I saying now? So Rocky, where the hell does he come into all this? Because but who is he? Because obviously, they didn't get into Season 2 with Jason, Zack, and Trini being replaced. They never lost their powers. They were always there. Trini died, but Tommy left the team too. Was Rocky brought on to replace Tommy?
Or was Rocky brought on after Jason died? In which case, he hasn't been around that long, has he?
No, because Jason dies after the Machine Empire takes over.
Also, why does he have that metal leg? I'm really fascinated by this robotic boot thing. So
I just want to know, where the hell does Rocky fit into all this? Because he's one of the most well-acted characters in the movie. He's played by James Vanderbeek, who's like a legit actor. And he's great. I just don't know where he fits into all this because of the different... Because I just don't know how faithful this storyline is to the original Mighty Morphin, because obviously, Tommy never became the Green Ranger. I mean, the White Ranger, because we see that the Power Rangers disbanded after Kimberly died.
Could it be that we're overthinking it?
I mean, definitely.
Because could it be that the person who wrote this didn't really give that much thought to continuity. You earlier compared this to Watchmen. And in Watchmen, it's exactly the same as this, pretty much. We get snippets of the things that happened in the past, but we never get a complete picture. You know what I mean? Details are left
That's
out.
True.
Details are fudged. We don't really know exactly what happened. And it's actually more realistic for that very reason. We don't know what the fuck happened. It's not like any other comic book property where somebody can say, well, in Hulk 365, this happened.
But I would say that the difference between this and Watchmen is that Watchmen is its own thing.
Hmm.
And then this is something that is based on a previously existing continuity.
True.
And seems to be following it up to a certain point. Again, we can't be sure about that. I'm sure there obviously have to be differences.
True, but given that it's in sort of its own sort of alternate reality from the show.
Mm-hmm.
Because it just simply can't be the exact events of the show as we perceive them, because we've already pointed out some continuity flaws with that. I think it can sort of be seen in the same light, is that maybe we're not supposed to fully understand how the continuity works. Maybe the person who wrote it doesn't even fully have...
I don't think we are either. The problem is, I just don't know how it all fits together in the context of its own story because of how all over the place it is in terms of what happened. You know what I mean? It's based on this conflict that I don't know what happened.
All we really have to know is that Rocky was on the team at some point. That he has now started working with the Machine Empire, that all of the other Rangers have been being hunted down, which is also very Watchmen.
Yeah, it is. It is very Watchmen.
And that, fuck, I just started thinking of...
Tommy's, it's interesting, Tommy's kind of the Rorschach of the situation.
I just started fucking thinking about that opening fight scene in Watchmen. God, I love that. Anyway.
It's about as violent as Watchmen. It's also really interesting because I guarantee you the writer of this looked at Watchmen for inspiration, because you can really pick out the different things that they did similarly. Zach working for the government to fucking go to governments and destroy them is kind of a combination of Dr. Manhattan and the comedian.
Yeah. But,
because he was addicted to the action, which is very similar to the comedian.
So anyway, the Power Ranger team has been being picked off one by one by a mysterious assassin who he believes to be Tommy, and now he's trying to find Tommy, and he is interrogating Kimberly. That's quote-unquote Kimberly. That's all we really need to know for the setup, you know?
Yeah, you're right, but I was just... Because it's a fan film, I feel like I need to know more about what exactly is in continuity, because the only people who are going to see this who are going to really care about it are people who are going to know Power Rangers.
Well, and that's,
now, maybe
that's
maybe
why,
the assumption
that's why
maybe the assumption is because it's Power Rangers, nobody cares. But I don't know. Because of how good this is, I wish it was a little bit more well thought out in that respect. So I almost hope we get more from this particular version of the universe.
That's why I also said that I would love to see more fan films from this guy set in this version of the Power Rangers universe. I think it would be fascinating.
I think it'd be really cool
to fill in some of these gaps. I don't know if it'll happen since there's been so much fucking controversy from people who can't, like, anyway.
It also looked really fucking expensive.
I'm sure it probably was, but, all except for what I'm going to complain. Can I get into my complaint?
Yeah, go ahead. Well, hang on. Let me just say this before you get into your complaint. So the special effects are amazing.
They are, which is why my complaint matters.
Yes, but also some of the practical costumes that are based on the original series don't look amazing. I'm not crazy about the redesigns of the Power Rangers costumes, in addition to what you're about to mention.
I didn't mind those. The thing that killed me.
Yeah.
The entire movie looks fantastic. It's so professional looking, and everything is so polished and cool and neat and stylized and gritty. And then you get to the end.
Yeah.
And I should set this up with what the big twist is at the end, which love this twist, by the way. The entire time Rocky is interrogating Kimberly, because he thinks that Tommy is the one who's been killing.
Right, he's using her as bait.
Then Tommy shows up, he fights Rocky, he beats Rocky, kills Rocky, if I'm remembering correctly.
No, Kimberly blows his brains out.
Oh, that's right. Kimberly blows Rocky's brains out. Then Tommy says, "Who are you?" Because...
Which, by the way, hang on before you go on. What I like about that is that Tommy never kills a former Power Ranger.
True.
Ever. Even if he intended to, he never does.
Anyway, he says, who...
And we don't know his intentions because he barely speaks in the whole fucking movie.
This is where he reveals, through flashback, and actually this was foreshadowed pretty well at the beginning of the movie, because the very first thing you see in the movie is a shot of the Pink Ranger helmet lying on the ground. That Kimberly was killed.
And you see that all the Rangers getting their asses kicked.
Kimberly was killed in battle long ago. Thus, the person that he is talking to is not Kimberly. This is actually Rita Repulsa in disguise, and she is the one who has been going around hunting down and killing all of the Rangers, which makes her far more effective a villain than she ever was in the show, by the way.
She's going for a completely different strategy than any Power Rangers villain ever, because she's basically waiting in the background to let somebody else do all the fucking work. The Machine Empire has taken over the entire world, and then she, in turn... takes over the Machine Empire!
Anyway, so Kimberly... I guess I'll use the word morph. Kimberly... transforms, a better word to use. Transforms...
Her skin cracks, and we're left to assume it's Rita Repulsa. Or we're not left to assume, we're shown.
She transforms into Rita Repulsa. This is the problem. The rest of this movie, as I already said, looks so good. And then Rita Repulsa looks like shit.
Yeah, she looks really bad.
Now, I have gone on record before as saying that you can't realistically, and I know I'm going to get I might get shit for this because I'm contradicting statements that I've made in the past. You shouldn't criticize the look or the special effects of a fan film, and I still stand by that. The problem is how good the rest of it looks, so that how bad she looks sort of stands out in a really bad way. Rita Repulsa looked better in the Nostalgia Critic review of Turbo, a Power Rangers movie.
Yeah, well, the problem is the head.
She looks nothing... I said this on Facebook. She looks like a fatter, shittier Maleficent.
Well, but it's like... if the head was not made of fucking cloth, then it wouldn't have been a problem. Like, if it was a hard plastic, it would have been fine. But it's this floppy fucking felt shit... that looks like she, like, made it herself. I mean, maybe she did. But, like, you know what I mean? Like, made it herself, like, out of fucking Party City products.
It just looks really bad. And, like...
it looks stupid.
She doesn't look like Rita at all. She doesn't have the... you know, I understood what they were going for with the horns, but you need to have the white hair, like, up in horn form.
Yeah, I didn't care so much about that. The thing that bugged me was...
all I ask is that my character look like the character they're supposed to represent.
I didn't mind the fur cloak either. Rita is very much so based on the Wicked Witch of the West.
Mm-hmm.
And I liked that because it was a reference to the Wizard of Oz.
Fucking rides around Tokyo on a flying bicycle.
Yeah, it's all one big reference to the Wizard of Oz. And in that way, I guess I should say Bandora is based on the Wizard of Oz, is based on the Wicked Witch, and then Rita was therefore kind of based on it accidentally. But my point is just, I didn't mind the fur
Rita
cloak.
Was just Bandora with bad dubbing.
Right. I didn't mind the fur cloak. I just wish the head wasn't made of fucking felt. That was my whole thing.
She just looks awful.
Yeah, she looks really bad.
And they try to do this voice morph thing to her to make her sound more like the original Rita, but she doesn't sound like the original Rita.
Yeah.
Again, she sounded better in that Nostalgia Critic review, too. They really should have just gotten the Nostalgia Critic version of Rita Repulsa. because while shitty, it would have looked more like Rita Repulsa than what we got.
Did you think that the ending was kind of, aside from Rita looking horrible, just the fact that her performance kind of was at odds with the rest of the movie? Just because Rita, their version of Rita was pretty much... Rita from the show.
Although far more clever.
Well, but that wasn't her. That was Kim. She was pretending to be Kimberly. So her performance prior to that point is basically a slightly more badass version of Kimberly.
Friends?
And we never... I don't have any friends. Basically, it's fucking Kimberly from Turbo.
Too much pink power is dangerous.
So... up prior to the moment the skin cracks all the way, we're not seeing Rita. So we only get really two lines from Rita herself, and I didn't think they matched up with the rest of the movie. It was just a little bit too Saturday morning in regards to the rest of the thing. Because Rita's being so calculating this whole time, I don't know, maybe it makes sense in, like, she's calculating and then she reveals herself and we know that Tommy's fucked. Because it's like, well, why hide now? I've basically taken over the world without actually, while barely lifting a finger.
Because now he's alone. He's the only Power Ranger left. He's at this point.
He's not even a Power Ranger anymore. He doesn't have his powers.
That's right. He has no
powers. As far as we know.
He seems to not have powers. He's unmorphed. And he's fighting.
It's unclear what exactly happened to the powers, by the way. We know Zack had his powers up until he died.
Right. We know that Kimberly had her powers up until she died, the real Kimberly.
Well, she died in the middle of the battle, so they all had their powers at that point.
The real Kimberly. It's unsure. It's unclear, rather, whether, what's his name? Jason had his powers when he was assassinated.
Yeah, also question.
Brutally assassinated.
Also, big question. So, I'm unclear on the sequence of events here. So Jason marries Kimberly.
At some point,
At some point. So that wasn't Rita, right? That was actually Kimberly.
Right, that was the real Kimberly.
As far as we know.
This is what I'm thinking happened.
So did Jason die before the final battle?
Did Jason die? And then that's when...
Maybe Rocky took over.
That's
okay,
when Rocky came in. Was Rocky maybe the Red Ranger that we saw running into battle at the beginning of the movie?
That's possible.
Jason died.
Okay.
It's not really ever explained how exactly Trini died.
Well, yeah, that was kind of a little nod to... And this might sound fucked up, but that was kind of a nod to what happened to the actress who played Trini, was that she died in the early 2000s.
Here's the question. Did morphing from girl to man so many times give her prostate cancer? No, that's not the question.
That's fucked up, but anyway.
The real question I was going to ask before I came up with that little gem was, did she die in that same battle from the beginning of the movie that killed Kimberly? Now, we see a flashback of them all standing at the funeral, that was Rita telling that story, and that could very well be a lie, because in that story, Rita, in Kimberly form, tells Rocky that she saw Tommy there, so that could have been a lie fabricated to tell him what he wanted to hear.
The other thing is, like, alright, so she says that that's the last time that she saw Tommy, but if we're assuming that the real Kimberly is the one who married Jason, then that's not possible, because... Tommy says she died in my arms. So I'm guessing that that's Rita lying then. Because the real Kimberly would say, I married Jason, he died, and then in the final battle, Tommy and I had one last moment, and then I died. Right?
So this is how I'm figuring the sequence of events.
Yeah, okay, so let's break this
down.
Vulcan
Skull fucking sell out to the Machine Empire and help them kill Jason brutally.
Oh, it's that scene, that whole sequence is where I was like, oh my fucking god.
Brutally kill Jason. Rocky is brought in to replace him. They go into battle.
Right, so against the Machine Empire.
Multiple battles, it could be. Maybe it was just the one battle, that's unclear. Trini dies either in the battle. She either dies in the same battle that Kimberly died in, or she died in some previous battle. But
no, that's not possible because Jason's at the funeral.
Jason is at the funeral. You're right. Okay, so Trini died long before that.
I'm assuming Trini died before
before
the Machine Empire even came into the equation.
So Trini dies before Jason. Maybe that's when they brought in Rocky.
So what, did Rocky become the Yellow Ranger?
He became Boy.
I mean, not that I have a problem with that, but it's just like, this changes everything now because Jason's at the fucking funeral. And then Kimberly...
He gets a vagina. He's like, there's something wrong with this morpher.
But that's the whole thing. It's like, so wait a minute, but she says that's the last time she saw Tommy, but there's a battle after that with Tommy in it, and I'm assuming Rita must be lying about that. For some reason to confuse Rocky. And I have no idea why she's lying.
Right.
Oh, wait a minute.
Well, obviously Rocky...
Also, Rocky can't have been at that battle because he would know Kimberly would be dead.
Obviously Rocky is not aware of Kimberly's death. Maybe he had already started working for the Machine Empire at that point.
Yeah, I don't know, because it's unclear whether or not he sells out before Bulker Skull.
If we're assuming that Jason died long before that battle took place, which he had to have because Kimberly was with him, all right? So if we're assuming that A, that was the real Kimberly, and that Rita didn't just have a hard-on for Jason. And B...
I mean, there are some lines in Power Rangers where it almost seems like Rita does have a hard-on for Jason, though. There's a line in Power Rangers Zeo where...
I don't know.
Jason's the Gold Ranger, and she goes, "You always look better in red." And I'm like, "Oh, Jason, you better run, pal." it's fucking creepy. You don't want Rita fucking you. By the way, there's an ad on Skype right now that just talked about the Power Rangers fan film. I think that's weird.
Interesting. But, so if we're assuming that Jason died before that battle, right, mm-hmm. then right. Rocky had to have been the Red Ranger in that battle, right?
Right. So then how does he not know that Kimberly's dead?
Maybe they had another Yellow Ranger in that battle. Maybe whoever took over as Yellow Ranger after...
Aisha?
Yeah, maybe she actually exists in this continuity.
So then where is she? Is she dead?
Maybe she died in that battle.
There's a scene where, you know, Rocky's, like, you know, sliding through, like, the different Rangers. We don't see a second Yellow Ranger, though. So who knows?
Hmm. True. Okay.
All right. This is confusing. This is the problem, though. I think this is one of the biggest problems of the movie is that...
What if during the battle, what if Rocky betrayed the Rangers during the battle, and it was that that led to them getting slaughtered as badly as they did, and then he runs off with the Machine Empire and isn't there while Tommy's cradling fucking Kimberly as she's dying. Therefore...
But we're saying that Jason died before this.
Right. So
then Trini can't have died in that battle, though. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Trini can't... But again, Jason was at the funeral.
Exactly. So Trini had to have died before Jason.
So then...
Again, assuming that this isn't... That scene,
what if that...
The whole problem with using that scene as an example is that it's clearly fabricated, at least to some extent, by Rita. And so it's unclear what about that scene is accurate and what about that scene is not. Rocky is not in that scene, is he?
We're talking about the opening scene right now, not the ending.
No, I'm talking about the funeral. Is Rocky at the funeral?
No, it's only the four. It's only Zach, Jason, Kimberly, and Billy. And then Tommy is in the background.
Okay, so Rocky was not...
So it has to have happened before the battle. So I'm assuming...
So if Rocky was not at the funeral, then he wouldn't have known whether or not Jason was there or not.
So you're saying that entire thing was come up with by Rita?
I'm saying that entire scene has to be put into question, and I don't think we can really use it in terms of trying to figure anything out because it's too questionable.
You know what? You know what the other thing is? That she's off. That scene's also a lie because, again, she says that's the last time that I saw Tommy, and that's not true because Kimberly died in Tommy's arms.
Right. The funeral scene, just we need to throw that out of the equation and not even attempt to figure out where Trini fits into all this.
This fucking movie is a mindfuck, bro. I need this fucking guy to fucking write out this script and be like, listen, this is the sequence of events because it's fucking bugging me. Yeah, I gotta know. The other thing is that, are you a little bit pissed off that the only figurehead of the Machine Empire that we get to see is Rocky? We didn't get to see King Mondo, Machina, Gasket, Sprocket.
Yeah, I mean, again, this movie was already expensive enough, and based on the shitty job they did at Rita, I really don't know if I want to see King Mondo.
Yeah, but it's also like, we see machines that look okay. There's a credit in the credits for it's General Clank, which is not what he was in Power Rangers Zeo, but whatever. He was a scientist in Power Rangers Zeo. So I'm assuming they're referring to... that big robot that destroys the Megazord?
Yeah.
Maybe that's Clank? But I just wanted to see some of them. Like, they talk. Like, the Machine Empire is the villain of the piece. I mean, I guess you could argue that Rocky and Rita are, but...
Well, the thing about it is that this particular story, right, while it takes place in this universe where all these huge things have happened, the story itself, the story of this fan film...
is about the Rangers.
It's a lot more personal in nature, you know, that it's not told...
Yeah, definitely.
It's not told with very many broad strokes. The only big mm-hmm. action sequences we get are in flashback.
The whole movie takes place in flashback, though. So, also, the biggest action scene that's really elaborated upon is Zack's fight with the North Koreans.
That is fucking awesome. I love how he used his helmet as a weapon.
Oh, that was badass! Any last words? Yeah, It's Morphin time. Oh, that was fucking awesome. Also, that actor looks familiar. Who is he?
I'm not sure. But you don't fight with a coked-up ranger. That's just not a thing.
Oh, he was fucking awesome. Also, I love the Captain America shot where Zach was up in the fucking plane. He jumps out of it. That was right out of Captain America. That was awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
He was addicted to the action. The Mastodon costume, by the way, is easily the best-looking of the redesigns because I don't like the Green Ranger costume. And we don't get enough of a look at the other ones for me to say whether or not I like those. I don't like the Pink Ranger one. The helmet looks fucking weird. They tried to subtract as much of the animals from the helmets as possible, which I think is kind of redundant. I guess it was all an attempt to make it look more realistic, but I don't know.
Yeah, to be realistic, why would they need to be animal themed?
But they already are, though.
Yeah, I know they already are.
Like, Zach's helmet has the Mastodon in it. It's just really, like, abstract. The other thing is that, like, there are military outfits that are animal themed. You know what I mean? Like, it's not an unrealistic thing to have, you know, militaries that have, like, aesthetically designed uniforms.
Yeah, but at the same time, I think...
Especially a superhero team.
I think what they were trying to do, though, is to have the animal theme, but to go more subtle with it.
I can see that. The Green Ranger helmet looked terrible. We see it for a second, but I did not like what I saw. I don't like the holographic shield. I thought that was just a really bizarre choice. It also looked really tiny, too. But aside from that, I mean, this movie is just, it's awesome. It's really entertaining. It's a little bit confusing plot-wise, as we said, but who knows. Given the framing device, it's impossible to tell what actually happened.
Just don't be an idiot like we were and try to analyze it.
Well, no, but the thing is, like, you can analyze it on a pure, like, character level, and it's very interesting. Again, I think it's cool that Tommy never actually kills anybody in the movie.
Oh.
Or at least a Power Ranger. He kills members of the Machine Empire, but...
They paint this picture of, my God, you know, Tommy's gone insane, and he's killing all these people, and we have to stop him. And it's like, nope.
Well, the only one we know he didn't kill is Billy, and Jason, obviously, because he wasn't there. But we assumed he killed Bulk and Skull. That's who those people were in that motel, right? That was Bulk and Skull.
Yeah. Well, right before Rita... reveals her true, like, self.
Yeah, we see all the people that she killed.
Yeah, we see quick flashback shots of her killing all those other Rangers. So,
right.
she fucking killed all of them, which is kind of embarrassing for them, given how shitty she looks.
I mean, but she's also telepathically kind of, like, suggesting, like, kill yourself, Billy. Okay. I also thought it was kind of fucked up that Billy killed himself.
Yeah, Billy fucking blew his brains out.
Yep.
He couldn't take it anymore, whatever it is.
Yeah, well, he was rich. But anyway, I really enjoyed this. Controversy aside, I thought it was great. I want to see more stuff from this universe, though, because I have tons of questions that I want answered.
It raises too many questions.
So, anyway, I really enjoyed it. Definitely give it a watch if you're a Power Rangers fan. But obviously, there's certain viewer discretion is advised. If you don't like gore, this is not the Power Rangers movie for you. If you don't like cursing, you don't want to see this because Bulk calls the Power Rangers a bunch of cunty fucks.
That was awesome.
that was the scene where I was like, Bulk, Skull, you saw Kimberly is covered in her husband's blood. Falls to the ground and looks up and sees Bulk and Skull there with fucking assault rifles.
That shot of her lying on the ground and yelling up at them as they're about to, like, perform a coup de grace, which they obviously failed at doing, is very Kill Bill Volume 1. And
Yeah, I thought that must have been a reference, mustn't it? It must have been. Because she's in a bride outfit and she's covered in blood.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it must be a reference.
And she's being betrayed. It's very Kill Bill.
And her saying, you know, Bulk, Skull, you ratted this out, is not that different from Uma Thurman saying, Bill, it's your baby, bang.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Also, Kimberly looks like fucking Uma Thurman in this movie.
Kinda. I can see it.
She's got the blonde hair. I mean, Kimberly wasn't a blonde in the original show. Anyway, that's not really
true. I think there's a misconception out there. And then
Yeah, she looked more... That's why when I first watched it, I was like, are they doing Catherine instead of Kimberly? But no, it was Kimberly. Also, James Vanderbeek looks nothing like Steve Cardenas, but whatever.
Well, I mean...
None of the actors they got really looked much like the original counterpart, but that
no,
doesn't matter.
That Tommy looks nothing like Jason David Frank.
I wanted to talk about this earlier, and I don't want to get back to the controversy, I just want to say, they originally approached Jason David Frank about playing Tommy in this, and I'm actually glad they didn't do that, because this really worked best as its own separate thing.
I agree.
So I'm glad that they didn't have any of the original cast in it.
I would have to agree.
But he said he didn't do it because it wasn't a Saban-blessed thing, and he only tends to do things where it's like Saban's cool with it. So it's like he's going to be in that superpower beatdown of a Green Ranger versus Ryu. So and he says that Saban's like, oh yeah, that's cool. So whatever. He also said some shit in the video that he taught where he talked about this movie. Where I'm like, that's kind of a dick thing to say. But aside from that, I don't know the guy, but he seems like a nice guy. So you know. Don't want to get into it.
Jason David Frank, I got mad props for you, you know? You're like...
You're an MMA fighter, I don't want to fuck with you.
You're like the closest thing to... You're like the closest thing that a lot of American people have to like a kung fu icon. you're the poor white man, Ian. But...
All right. That's kind of a backhanded compliment.
The point is, you have prestige.
Sure.
You are well liked.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I like the guy. I follow him on Facebook. He's a cool guy.
I love you in Dino Thunder.
I just think that he says things sometimes where I'm like, that's kind of a dick thing to say.
But it's, when it comes to the subject of this fan film, I just think that maybe you're overreacting.
He needs to shut the fuck up.
I think maybe you're overreacting. Just a tad.
Well, he doesn't get angry or anything. He's just like, it's not my cup of tea. And he was very, to be fair, he was very respectful in the video. I saw the video. He was very respectful. He was very clear, like, this is just my opinion. And he was very well-spoken about it. But the only thing that pissed me off about it was just like, he was just like, this is the only thing that he said that kind of made me go, this isn't nearly as good as the fan film we're making with Green Ranger versus Ryu. And I'm like, all right, you didn't need to crap on somebody else's art just to fucking pimp out the plotless fight that's going to happen. All right. That was kind of a dick move in my
opinion. Well, now that I know he said that, fuck you.
I've seen the superpower beatdowns. They're awesome, but listen, they're plotless fight scenes. So don't get all like, oh, it's going to be.
They don't make as much of an attempt at plot as Death Battle.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Death Battle is better in terms of, like, stats and shit. Like, because Superpower Beatdown is based on viewer rating.
Yeah, Superpower Beatdown is based on viewer rating. The reason I love Superpower Beatdown is that it's live action.
It's live action, and that Predator fucking Wolverine thing is amazing.
That was awesome. Fucking, there was another one that I really liked. I think it was...
Batman versus Deadpool was cool. Batman versus Darth Vader. Holy shit, that was amazing.
Punisher versus Red Hood.
Yeah, that was cool.
Bunch of different examples. Fucking Scorpion versus the White Ranger.
That was cool. I thought it was bullshit that the White Ranger was able to teleport, but whatever.
Yeah, whatever. So yeah. But, what was I even... I had a point.
I mean, you said fuck that asshole before. I don't know if you were kidding, but...
That was a joke. Okay, I think the point I was trying to get to is all you people who are complaining about the fan film, we could go around and around and around in circles and have intellectual conversations about why this isn't as bad as you're making it out to be and how you shouldn't put the franchise in a box because it's harmful to the possibilities of said franchise, yada, yada, yada. But at the end of the day, here's the main thing I'm going to say to you. Chill out. This is not a big deal.
No, it's not. It's only a big deal because Saban and the people who made the original Power Rangers have reacted to it.
They made it a big deal.
Yeah, absolutely.
I almost feel like maybe they're not even as mad about it as they're letting on, and that
Do you
this
think
is
it could be a PR stunt.
I think this is all them taking advantage of this fan film for some publicity. And if I'm right about that, they're fucking geniuses.
Because that movie is coming soon. I don't know. I don't want to get all conspiracy theorists, but because I've heard nothing but good things about the original PR cast and their interactions with fans. I don't want to talk shit.
I'm not talking about the cast of PR. I'm talking more about Saban itself.
Yeah, Saban is shady. I'm not gonna lie, Saban's pretty fucking shady. But the original cast, I'm not gonna talk
about. I mean,
the
whole concept of we're gonna take this foreign film, right, and we're just gonna cut in some American footage, and we're gonna fool people into thinking we made it. That's already shady on the basest level.
Yeah. Also, you know, I've seen Power Rangers Dino Charge. You know, this was better.
This was better. Take that, Jason David Frank.
Yes. Take that.
Fuck you.
I love how it's like we have a dog in this fight now, apparently.
No, but Jason David Frank, I love you, man. No.
Yeah, I'm a big fan.
You're the Black Dino Ranger, man.
Yeah.
I can't hate the Black Dino Ranger.
No.
Fucking going on vacations and having to be in costume for several episodes at a time.
Yeah. Hey, let's get angry again. Yeah, fuck this guy.
And then you were invisible. The fuck?
Yeah, what the fuck? I mean, then he went inside his own head and fought the previous Rangers, but left out the Turbo Ranger.
Also, way to do a really shitty job of explaining the history of Power Rangers to a new generation of Power Rangers. Jesus.
Yeah.
Leaving out shit.
Linkara
should have done it.
Yeah. Yeah. What do you have to say about that, Jason Dimbrek? Nothing. I'm not here. Well, you know what? That's your fucking problem.
Moral outrage.
Dylan, let's talk about a fan film that wasn't nearly as controversial, but is a little bit is comparably gritty.
And comparatively good, I think.
And
also is a little bit of a different proposition because rather than be the a standalone film, it is supposed to be the first in a new web series, similar to that Mortal Kombat web series that was so popular.
Mortal Kombat Rebirth.
No, not Rebirth. There was like a fan film that was supposed to launch a series called Rebirth, but then they made it was called something else. Hold on.
Okay. Well, we're talking about Dragon Ball Z.
I need to find out what this fucking thing was called, because now this is gonna fucking bug me. It's called Legacy. Mortal Kombat Legacy, which was so popular, you can now buy it on fucking Blu-ray. You can go to Walmart and find the fucking Blu-ray of Mortal Kombat Legacy. I've even seen Blu-ray.
Really?
I've even seen Blu-ray releases where they coupled Mortal Kombat Legacy with the old movies.
That's amazing. Wow.
But anyway, so yeah, this is more comparable to that in that this is going to be an ongoing series. This is the first episode of Dragon Ball Z, the Light of Hope, is that what it's called?
Yeah, that's it.
Also a different proposition from the last fan film we just discussed because
it's an adaptation.
Yes, unlike a reinterpretation, this is a straight up adaptation of the history of Trunks special, and I'm assuming that they're gonna like stretch it out over episodes and go into more detail and explore, like,
which I think is awesome.
Explore character things. Hopefully, they do more than just what that original special did, though, because at some point it's gonna be tiring just having those two villains. Like, I hope they bring in Cell at some point. But that's all speculative.
I mean, they'll have to change the continuity, but whatever. I'm not gonna cry foul if they do that.
No, I wouldn't.
So let's kind of get into what this is. So, Dylan, let me ask you this. Is this or is this not made by the same people who made that trailer for Dragon Ball Z, the Saiyan Saga? That live action. It came out a couple years ago. You know the one I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do know what you're talking about. I don't know if this is by the same people, though.
It looks about of the same quality, and that's a good thing.
That is an excellent. Oh, the quality of this was amazing.
This is the best possible, at least in terms of my own, how I can imagine it, this is the best possible, this is the closest you are ever going to get to perfect DBZ live-action interpretation. This is the closest you can possibly get.
This is what Dragon Ball Evolution should have looked like and should have been like.
And you know what? It didn't even look that different from that. It just all came down to style and attitude.
Presentation and stuff like that. Yeah, in terms of the actual physical effects that were used, you're right. It doesn't look all that different from Dragon Ball Evolution. Now, I will say that in terms of like things like costume design, it's more faithful to the original than
Evolution. Yeah, definitely.
They're also picking a
period in DBZ where it's the easiest to do that, to kind of interpret it in live action.
They nailed the androids. Not just in terms of look, but also the way they were being acted, especially since these are, of course, the versions of the androids from the history of Trunks' timeline. which is
right, which is the timeline where Goku died of the accelerated heart disease, and Gohan became Trunks' mentor, and now they're training to stop the androids.
Right. You know, the androids in that continuity and in that special history of Trunks are portrayed, which we talked about in an episode of DBZ Movie Reviews, plug.
That's on my channel.
Yes.
You can go back.
That is one of the episodes that had to be uploaded on his channel. Episode 6, I do believe.
Yeah, you can. There's also a playlist on Dillion's channel where you can watch the whole series, so you can go find
that. Yeah, you should do that. You know, fuck Bill's channel. Go...
You know what? Watch all. I mean, I'm still gonna get the views because even if they watch it through your playlist, they're gonna click on my channel.
Yeah,
but whatever.
The important thing is that they'll be watching the majority of the series on my channel, and that's
you know, man, that's cool. I want everybody listening to go subscribe to SuperDM64. He never makes any videos, but whatever.
I occasionally do things. I go through spurts of doing things, and
he occasionally uploads an episode of Kaiju Spotlight like once a year.
Hey. I uploaded 6 episodes.
Now who's talking shit? Now who's talking shit?
How's that Yeti review coming?
I'm working on it, actually. I'm actually working on it.
Have you already watched the movie?
Not yet. I'm planning out the events.
You poor son of a bitch.
I don't want to watch the movie. I'm dreading it. It's so fucking... I've seen the trailer. I rewatched the trailer to reacclimate myself. And it's fucking dumb. I'm dreading it.
I almost feel bad.
You should.
I will say this. To people who don't know me personally, it may seem like the punishment I chose for Bill in that wager was far worse than the punishment that he chose for me. But if you knew...
It really wasn't, though, is the thing.
If you knew me personally, you would realize... that he went right for the fucking jugular. But anyway.
This is... See, people are like, oh, Dillion's putting... Whenever Dillion's a sarcastic asshole, he's putting on a performance. No, he's that in real life, too.
Yeah.
I mean, I hung out with this guy for a week straight in person. And he's, you know, it's, you know... He's, you know, you're not a very, kind of emotionally supportive man, I must say.
No.
I would not... I love you, man. You're my bro, but there are moments where I'm like, ow, Dillion, that hurt.
I'm more like Red Foreman.
I would compare you to Red. I would say that's... You know, no, I disagree with that. You're Hyde. You're definitely Hyde.
Hyde? Really? Hyde?
You're Hyde. Yep. You're Hyde.
How am I Hyde?
Because you are. You're a sarcastic dick. And that was Hyde.
All right.
I mean, not a stoner, and that disappoints me, but whatever.
All right, fine. I will submit.
I'm definitely Eric.
This is my new hypothesis. I will submit that when I am in a chill, happy mood, I'm probably Hyde.
Yeah.
When I'm angry, I probably turn into Red.
Yeah, okay. So I'm Eric. You're Hyde. Andres is definitely Kelso.
Oh, really? He's not Fez?
Fez. Yeah, I meant Fez.
I thought he would be Fez for obvious reasons.
Oh, he's definitely Fez. Not because of the race, just because of the outlook on life. So anyway, so back to DBZ.
What were we fucking talking about?
Oh,
yeah. What I was trying to say before we somehow got onto that tirade is that they really nailed the androids, because watching this movie... or this fan film, web series, episode 1, what the fuck ever, you might come to the conclusion that the androids were being portrayed as more vicious than they were in the show. But in reality, the versions of the androids that exist within the History of Trunks outline are much more like pure evil and vicious than the ones from the main continuity of the show. The ones that happen in the normal DBZ timeline are more playful in nature.
Yeah, well, the other thing is that they didn't have that... They have a long time to get fucked up in the History of Trunks timeline.
They've been around, and they killed Goku and fulfilled their, like, purpose that Dr. Gero set them out for, and then it was like, what are we going to do now? And they start killing humans for fun, and they just become soulless machines.
They're bored. That's the whole point of their story, is that they're fucking bored. And they portray that very accurately in this little short.
They got them perfectly from the fucking... bright blue eyes to the fucking attitude to the dialogue.
The clothes were perfect.
The dialogue was amazing.
17 using a gun was a nice little reference.
Yes. 18 being like, can you just hurry up and kill them? Because, like, 18 yep. said that shit all the time.
Yep, definitely. And let me say this in regards to, you know, we talked about the Power Rangers one before this. This one is about as gritty as the story was. I don't think they add any grit to this really whatsoever that wasn't already present in the original story.
Yeah, you know, people fucking die. And, you know, it's not as much of a change as it was for the Power Rangers thing, because people fucking die in DBZ anyway.
DBZ has very, very dark moments, and this was very much so in line with the story they were adapting. So it's, the fighting is, the choreography isn't, like, brilliant. I mean, you don't get to see a ton of it because it's very fast, but the actual kind of, style of the fighting is very classic DBZ, and I thought that was great. What do you think of the acting aside from the androids?
Okay, this is going to be my big complaint with the film.
Yep, me too.
I think the Gohan guy does a pretty good job.
He's okay. The Trunks kid...
That's the problem for me. This child... Yeah. This child who is playing Trunks.
He's too young, number one.
Well...
He's about...
He's more like Kid Trunks' age, whereas in the original History of Trunks special, he was
like 13.
He was portrayed more as like Teen Gohan age.
Yeah, which is why I think they should have gone older. Or they could have just made him older than he was. I think that would have been better for the acting.
It could be possibly that maybe this kid won't be playing Trunks the whole time. Like, maybe they'll have some, like, time skip shit and have him grow older as he's training with Gohan. And I would be fine with that, because this kid...
I don't know, I kind of doubt it.
Because this kid should not act ever in anything.
He's very young.
He is very young, you know. And he's, you know... You know, the thing about DBZ is this dialogue would be hard for an adult to pull off and sound like a real fucking person, because it's the DBZ fucking universe.
But the problem is, like, here's the problem with
it. So you're putting that on a kid's shoulders, and it kind of ruins some moments that are supposed to be emotional for his character. Like, you know, he's like the moment where Gohan is telling him about Vegeta, which is pulled straight out of the History of Trunks.
It's way too short, and it's not played for the proper emotional depth, but... And it's mostly because of the delivery. It's too quick, and there's just no emotion behind it from really either of them. You get a little bit more from Gohan, though. He's creepy motherfucker. He talks way too much to himself.
If I can say anything, they got the hair right.
Yeah, he looks good. I just think that
why wasn't Bulma's hair blue? Did you see any blue in her hair? I didn't see any blue.
Her hair was blue.
It was.
Yeah.
All right. Maybe I wasn't looking hard enough.
And Trunks' hair was appropriately gray.
His hair was purple.
So anyway.
Fucking jackass.
His hair was appropriately silver. So anyway.
You fucking. Fuck you. It's fucking purple.
So.
I'm looking at the fucking DVD right now.
So speaking of hair, let's talk about the major thing in this: live action Super Saiyan transformation. Pretty much perfect.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't really get a super good look at it, though. You know what I mean?
Really? Didn't we?
Well, I mean, what I wanted to get a super good look at was the hair. And I didn't really get that because when
you... You mean when it was glowing?
Yeah, like I didn't...
Okay, I see that. Definitely.
I didn't really get to see a good enough shot of his head to see if they really did it justice. And then he's like...
I mean, it's gold.
And then he's flying
around
and fighting with 17, which, by the way, the best thing about this, as with the show and History of Trunks, is those action scenes. My God, is that fight amazing.
Yeah, it's this really impressed me. It looks almost as good as, like, Man of Steel did, I would say.
Oh, yeah.
The CG isn't quite as well integrated, but that's just, like, listen, that's just a matter of budget and time.
Again.
Comparing it to, like, major Hollywood releases, you guys got to pick up the slack, because this is not that far off. And these guys aren't getting paid for what they're doing.
Exactly. You guys are getting paid millions of dollars.
We're really seeing the kind of, like, we're really seeing Hollywood tested now, and I don't think right now they are meeting up to the test.
And maybe that's a good thing. Maybe that will lead to good change in the future.
Yes, I agree. Well, I think this is what will happen, is that the internet will be like, listen, we're doing this shit for free, and it looks about as good as what you're doing. You need to step up your game, motherfuckers.
I think so as well.
That's what I think is going on. But anyway,
I mean, the key effects in this looked about as good as what Evolution did, or the airbending in the Avatar movie.
This looked better than Evolution, I think, CG integration-wise.
Yeah. Granted, I haven't watched Evolution in a while, nor do I plan to rewatch it simply to see.
And the other thing, I mean, I haven't watched it since we did that commentary.
Yeah, either, and I hope never to again.
And the other thing is that this is way more stylized. So even if the CGI isn't perfectly integrated, it's fine because it's supposed to look a little bit more cartoony anyway.
Yeah, I love they didn't try to do what Evolution did. You know, they didn't try to create this strange Never Never Land that's a mixture of the DBZ and real universe.
It's live-action DBZ.
It's just the live-action DBZ.
Yeah, I mean, the buildings are real buildings, but, I mean, we only see them from a distance anyway.
And that
doesn't matter.
And again, budget.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it was all CG, but whatever.
I'm not expecting round.
Though, to be fair, the Capsule Corp building looks like fucking one of the Capsule Corp domes. I mean, they basically ripped it off from Iron Man.
That's fair. The other thing you gotta realize is that we're seeing like destroyed chunks of city, and there are square buildings integrated with the more unique looking buildings in DBZ.
You're absolutely right. Very true. I thought that the Super Saiyan. The only problem I had with I didn't have the problem with it. I thought we got a good enough look at the hair. My only issue with the Super Saiyan transformation was that we didn't have that little explosion of light that concretely completes the transformation that you're usually supposed to have in a Super Saiyan transformation.
Yeah.
Where it's the build-up, it's supposed to be that little pop. That never happened. It just kind of, the build-up just stopped and Gohan was a Super Saiyan. And that bugged me because this is the first time we saw a really good-looking live-action Super Saiyan transformation.
Yeah. You know, I really hope that they...
Well,
I hope that they, at some point over this series, that we get to see some of the other Z Fighters, like, in flashback.
I really hope... I want to see this team do a flashback to Gohan watching Goku go Super Saiyan for the first time. Because I really want to see these guys envision that sequence in live action. I
also want to see...
Shot for shot.
I also want to see what they do to achieve Goku's hair.
Or to show Frieza.
Yeah, that would be amazing to show Frieza.
I'd love to see it. I've said many times before, and I know that maybe some people who know me and in our talks about DBZ will call me out on this. I've said many times before, I don't need live-action DBZ. I don't think it's a good idea. I still stand by that to a certain extent. But as I said earlier, this little short is about as close as I think you can get to doing a good live-action DBZ. But again, I'm gonna have the same thing about this that I said about Power Rangers. I don't need this. It's just really cool that we got to see it. You know what I mean? Like, we've got really good animated DBZ stuff right now with Battle of Gods, and hopefully the next movie is equally as good. So, you know, room to explore. Let's try live-action DBZ again, and this was really good. It worked. So let's wrap up on this, Dylan, because I don't really have much else to say. I think that the dialogue in the acting will probably improve as the series goes down.
Yeah, probably.
So I'm hoping that'll happen. But aside from that, I really, really enjoyed this.
I just really hope that they can keep it up, because this was really fucking good.
Yeah, and hopefully that how much this must have cost them won't become an issue later on.
And it's a really good adaptation, you know. I feel like we didn't.
Yeah, very. It's almost word for word.
I feel like we don't have as many complaints as this as we do with the Power Rangers thing, just because there were some troubles in terms of adaptation involved.
Well, I mean, yeah, and the other thing is that this is pretty much word for word of the original DBZ source material.
Yeah.
And this is also not a reboot. This is an adaptation.
Right.
So that's the other thing. So it feels a little bit different.
Now, how many episodes they get out of this will be interesting to see. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Because if they're just straight up adapting History of Trunks. I mean, if it were me, I probably wouldn't be doing it as a straight up adaptation. I probably would be taking some license. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I would do it as a five-part miniseries is what I would do.
Mm. Yeah.
Just to keep up this quality of special effects.
Yeah, it's probably best, yeah.
Like a five-part miniseries. But that's up to them. I'll watch whatever they put out, because that Super Saiyan transformation was awesome.
Yeah, I'm very happy with what we got here.
Yeah. As am I. So yeah, nice little fan film centered episode of the Demons from Outer Space, Dylan.
Indeed, yeah.
So fan films, what's your take on them? Are they a bastardization of loved childhood icons, or are they a beautiful experiment of what could possibly be done with these things that we grew up with? What do you think? Leave it in the comments. Put it on Facebook. Put it on Toho Nation, which you can, which is the SOS and Godzilla fan group that you can join on Facebook. You can also like the SOS Network homepage for updates and all things SOS related. Get every new podcast when it comes out. You get to see a bunch of other stuff connected to us. Pretty much anything we put up on there. So if you want to follow the SOS's work, it's pretty much a requirement. It's probably not a requirement, but it would behoove you to like that page. So go ahead and do that. And that's pretty much it for announcements from me. How about you?
Yeah. Nothing specific to announce. I do want to do an episode of Kaiju Spotlight sometime soon. I'm feeling the itch. I'm just not entirely sure what I'm going to do yet. So look for that at some point.
We do have plans for videos in the future in terms of reviews and stuff. I know we're going to try and get together with Andres at some point in the near future and do a review of Rulers of Earth Volume 4.
Yeah.
I'm just not sure when. My schedule's kind of been confusing right now, but hopefully within a week or so we'll be able to hammer down a date, get that recorded, and we can put that up for you guys, because that came out a while ago, so I want to get that up before Volume 5 comes out.
Also, when we both get done watching Jew Ranger, and I don't know if we'll do this as a separate video or just do it on DFOS, we were planning to do a review of the series in its entirety when we get done watching it.
Right, so we're going to do that as well. We're going to, once we finish that, I don't know when that's going to be. That's probably going to be a little while. Again, I'm kind of taking my time with Jew Ranger because of what it is.
Exactly.
Whenever we finish that, we'll sit down and we'll do a review. Whether or not it will be on DFOS, we'll have to see.
It'll probably be sometime fucking next year, but we'll do another DBZ movie review.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. Well, we're really talking about it in advance.
I found out recently when that movie is coming out in theaters in Japan. I was like, it might not be as long as I thought it was going to be, because the movie is actually coming out in Japan in April.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, now, I don't know how long it's going to take for Funimation to fucking dub it.
Oh, who fucking knows? It took them forever to do Battle of Gods.
Dub it and bring it to America. I hope it doesn't take them as long. Now that
it took them 2 years of Battle of Gods.
Now that they've already done Battle of Gods and like they know that there's interest in buying DBZ movies,
I'd love to know how much money they made off that. By the way,
yeah, I'm not really sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hope it was a lot because I want to see this new one.
You reassembled the team. You have a voice actor for Beerus now, which is important because he's in the next movie, according to the poster.
Which is great.
So you know, just get off your ass, Funimation.
Yeah, Funimation, stop being so lazy.
Don't make me track down this movie and watch it subbed and then review it that way, which I mean I could.
Oh, I don't want to hear those voice actors. I want to hear my voice actor. I want to hear America's Dragon Ball Z.
Fucking high-pitched Goku, Kame!
Kame! I don't want to hear that. I want to hear Kame!
And then Vegeta's like, find a refresher.
Find a refresher. Listen, as long as Vegeta sings and dances again, I'll be happy.
My technique! I listened back to the episode of DBZ Movie Reviews, the last one, and we were talking about fucking Plan to Eradicate All Super Saiyans, and right. I forgot about that fucking thing in that movie about how Vegeta's obsessed with his Final Flash, until I was listening back to the review, and I was like, oh yeah, that's right.
Oh, isn't he, like, heartbroken by the fact that it doesn't work?
It's really fucking strange in that movie. It's like his Final Flash is just the end-all be-all, and if that don't work, well, then we're all fucked off.
Oh, we're all fucked. Yeah, it's not like he has any other bigger attack. Big Bang, Vegeta. Wait a minute, is the Big Bang before or after the Final Flash? It's after, isn't it?
I thought Big Bang was before, because Big Bang was first used to kill Android 19.
And he didn't use Final Flash until
later on.
Cell.
Yeah, it was at least Cell.
I think it was Imperfect Cell when he first used the Final Flash, if I'm not mistaken. I could very well be wrong. Though, you know what? Final Flash always struck me as his spirit bomb, as opposed to Goku's, and that's confusing. I'm not even going to get into that. I just remember that they combined Big Bang with Kamehameha in DBGT, but we won't even get into that.
Final Refresher.
So, Dylan, that's going to do it for this week's episode of The Demons from Outer Space. Until next time, I'm Bill Worster, a.k.a. Zazubaar.
I'm SuperDan64, and please, in the comments, leave your own theories about how Trini died.
how though, and when exactly did Kimberly marry Jason? Stay true, kids, and always remember, them Germans, they be fucked up. As well as those machines, they be fucked up too, them and their mech.
Did Zordon perform the ceremony? Damn it, we need answers.
We need answers, damn it. Good night, kids.